Alright, so today we're going to be talking about the average rate of change. So, when something is changing, how much is it changing? So let's go ahead and look at a function here. Maybe this is, have you ever gone on, y'all ever do shopping online? Any of you? Sure, y'all go to the store. Anybody do shopping? I do a little bit of shopping online. Right, Amazon is a kind of a big site when it comes to online shopping. You may or may not have heard of it. Anybody seeing some confused faces? That's okay. I don't know about you, but I've gone to Amazon and sometimes they will have the price will be like a really good deal, and then like I'll go a couple days later and it's gone up. Has that ever happened to you?
Yeah.
Oh, I hate it.
That's depressing.
Yeah, it fluctuates. Okay, nobody doesn't fluctuate as much as I'm going to show. Normally it doesn't drop half, but we're going to pretend like it does. Okay, so yeah, it goes up and down. In fact, if you knew what you were doing, you could possibly like buy a whole bunch of stuff when it was really cheap and then resell it again when it was really hot, you know, when the price went up. But then you got to time everything just right. I made this out of a break here, but I didn't really intentionally do that. So let's say that we have, this is the cost in dollars over the time. And this is per day. And we can see the price starts off at something kind of reasonable, but then it dipped down, then it went back up again. Once again, it should be nice and continuous. I'm not sure. It's just getting worse and worse each time I do it here. Okay, we got we lined up? There we go. Okay. So this is a continuous function. If you remember, we talked about that a little bit before. And sort of the interesting thing about this continuous function that it's always changing, okay? It's always never really constant. It's never really the same. So one thing that we might want to know or complain about is how much it changed, right? We're like, oh, the price went down by $2, you know? Okay, well, $2 went from between yesterday and today, or it went down $2 from like last week. See what I'm saying? If you say the price went down $2, you need to give a little bit more information if you're going to be, you know, accurate on that. Because from here to here, the change was maybe it dropped, you know, from $4, now it's down to $2. But if we were talking about from here to here, what's the change?
Increase.
That's six. Yeah, it's an increase. Increased by $2. But what if we talked about it from this time to this time?
Increased
$4. Okay. So if you're talking about the change, you have to be a little bit more specific. How much did it change? You have to say, well, it changed this much over this period of time. So when we're talking or referring to the change, we normally use the amount that it's changed. We'll say changed amount per time period. So we'll just say 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. So if we're looking in this region right here, we'll call that region A. How did the price change in region A? Go and say it, Jasmine. Okay, it dropped down $2, so it was negative $2 over the course of 2 days. If we wanted to, we could simplify that fraction, since we like doing that in mathematics. We can say negative $1 per 1 day. Or it dropped a dollar per day. What about in this region right here, which we'll call region B? Somebody else? What was the change? What was the...
From 2 to 6.
That's how much it changed. Now, what was the rate of change? Okay. It was it $4, 2 or 6? Okay, so what, $4, because it was at 2, then it went up to the 6, so it changed $4 per, how many days was that? 1, 2, 3 days? So from 2 to 5? So over the course of 3 days. If we want to, we can simplify that. We could say, you know, 4 thirds, it's about $1.33 per 1 day. So technically, this amount is not just the change, this is the rate of change. Okay, the change would just be like, did it go up or down? Or if you're talking about the rate of change, you have to give that time period, okay? You have to say, I changed this much over this period of time. And positive would normally mean it goes up, negative would mean that it's dropping. Okay, so sometimes things that people want to know about is the average rate of change. So, before I go write that down. We said that from here to here went from 2 up to 5, 2 up to 6 there over the course. The thing is, if I was talking about this time period, I'd say, oh man, it went up at $1.33 per day, okay? The question is, was it changing that much all the time, okay? In other words, that's how much, yeah, that's this delta y over this delta x. That's the slope right there between those two points. But was it changing at that rate all the time? Mm-hmm. I mean, like, look at it from right here to like almost that same day, but just a little bit later. Let me see if I can draw this line real nice and smooth. The question is, was it always changing at 1.33? What if I go from this point to that point that's right next to it? Zoom in. Zooming in. Here's that curve right there. From here to right there. So like after 2 days and like 1 minute, what's the change here? That slope right there going to be? Is that the same slope as this line right here? Which I'll draw like that. No? I seem to have lost all of you on that question. Let me see if I can give you a better example.
I think you're just asking if the rate of change was always linear, but it wasn't.
It's not always linear, that's correct. What about this one right here? Starts off at $4, it goes up, and then it comes back down, and it's $4 right there. Okay? What's the change between day 0, 1, 2, 3, 4? Okay? What's the change?
Zero.
No change. Was it always a zero change?
No.
Nah. If I had done it up here, then it would have been a different change. See what I'm saying? If I had found the time right here, it would have been a different change. So, when we're talking, so that's just something you need to keep in mind, that if you ask what's the rate of change, well, the average rate of change is you're just looking at the beginning and the end point. You're not really giving any other information about what could have happened all in between here. And that could, you could have a lot of different, you could have said, well, it's going up in here and then it's decreasing here and stuff like that. So just some stuff to keep in mind. Now I'll move forward here. All right, so I'm going to draw a very generic graph here. Cost, it'll dip down and come back up here. And this will be a cost function. So C as a function of T. So this is our cost on our y-axis, t on our x-axis. I'm going to pick a value right here. I'll call it 2, day 2. And then another value up here, 3. So the y value right here is c of 2. The y value right here is c of 3. The distance between those two points, we can tell that it's 1. We'll make it a little bit more generic. I'll call that delta t, the change in the time. The change vertically, I mean, we don't actually have what those values happen to be, but we can make this a little more generic, and we can say it's delta c, that's the change in cost. Okay? So, if I want to figure out what is the average rate of change from t equals 2 to t equals 3, based on what we saw previously, that's going to be the change in the c value, how much it changed vertically, divided by the change in the time. So it's this over that. Now you've seen this sort of thing before. What does this resemble?
Y over x.
Okay, delta y over delta x. You know it as slope. Okay? So I'm going to put m right there. Technically, we would say it's the slope of the line that connects those two dots. And in mathematics, there's a special name for a line that connects two dots, and that line is called the secant line. All right? It has absolutely nothing to do with the trig ratio secant. It has everything to do with the Latin, Greek, I can't remember. I'll say it's Latin. The Latin word secare, which is to cut. Yeah, it's Greek. Is it being os? Yeah, Latin. So it's the cut line because it cuts the function at that point and that point. So we would say delta c over delta t is the slope of the secant line. So put SEC over there. The average rate of change between two x values is equal to the slope of the line connecting those points on the function. If I wanted to expand this out on this particular case, delta c, we could write that as c of 3 minus c of 2 divided by 3 minus 2. If you actually wanted to apply the slope formula, y2 minus y1 over x2 minus x1, that's kind of a thing. All right. Now, here's a question for you. What does that average rate change? Depend on. Where it was, average rate change. What, just call out to me, what are the different things, if I'm trying to find that secant line, what am I dependent on? What values? What things?
Time.
Okay, what do you mean by time?
Change in time.
Okay, it depends on the change in time. How do you figure out where the change in time is? Okay, the beginning.
Of the 2 points. Do you do more than 2 points?
No, because you've got to have 2 points and you draw the line. If you pick a third one, then you have to make sure that it's on the line, and that just kind of ruins the point.
Okay.
So the beginning and the end. What if I said, instead of the beginning and the end, the beginning and how far you are from the beginning. So the beginning and the delta T. Because I could choose, this is my beginning, and then a delta T kick over this far. Or this is my beginning, and kick over maybe only this far, figure out what that secant line is. Or this is the beginning, and kick out just a little bit, that's my delta T. Alright? There's something else that it depends on. It doesn't just depend on the starting point and how far you're going over. What else does that change depend on? You get this taken care of, the delta T. What about up here? What does that secant line depend on? It's not like a super complex question. Say it again? Okay, it depends on the slope, but that's kind of what we're calculating.
Is the change of cost?
Okay, the change in cost. Yeah, I'm looking for, it depends on the function. It depends on if this function is going up or if this function is going down or if it's going back and forth or whatever. So yeah, it also does depend on, so we've got, depends on the beginning, depends on how far you're kicking over, and it depends on function. I'll put f of x. I can put c of t, but just we've got that function. Alright? So, if you were complaining about the cost, you could say, oh, this is so annoying. The cost is changing. It's going up by, $5 every day, Or you could say, oh, it's so terrible. It's going up by, $2 every 12 hours, right? Or you could say $2.50. Or it's going up $1 every 30 minutes. You see what I'm saying? Like, you could talk about the rate of change, and you give all sorts of different time frames. You could talk about the rate of change from here to here. You can talk about the rate of change from here to here. You can talk about the rate of change from here to here. In fact, you could even talk, this is terrible. The price on Amazon here is going up, 10 cents a minute, 3 cents a second, all right? Every millisecond it's going up half a cent. See what I'm saying? Like, you could talk about that. I wonder if you could even talk, this is how much it's changing, the nanosecond, or instantaneously. If you imagine that, you bring that time all the way down. Okay? So, here's a question. Alex, make sure that we're still in here. Can I have a formula, or is there a formula, or a way to find the average rate of change given those things? So I don't have to go and draw the picture, so I don't have to go and do all stuff. Can I find the average rate of change? And the answer is yes. So let's unpack this. Delta C over delta T. So that was C evaluated at point A minus C evaluated at point B.
Was that B minus A?
Yeah, okay, sure. Over B minus A. There's B. So here's C of A. There's C of B. And this one right here is the change. Let's call that X. So I'm going to call this delta X. So don't really like this. C of B minus C of A all over delta X. That looks a little bit better. But going on what we were talking about earlier, I don't want to lock in and call this A. I'm just going to call that X. So that I don't have to pick one specific point. I want that to just be any point, anywhere that I want on that graph, X. Now, if that's the case, this right here is not C of A, it's C of X. Don't erase it, just scratch the line through it so you can see what we're doing here. So if this is X and this is delta X, then instead of B, what's the way that I could write B in terms of X and delta X?
Delta X plus X.
I like it, but we're going to switch it just because that's the way mathematicians have always done it. X plus delta X. So this is any arbitrary point X. This is our delta. Now that's going to change my C of B. Okay, so that's no longer going to be C of B. See how good you are. That's going to be close. C of X plus delta X. Some weird stuff, Mr. Gard. What in the world are you teaching us? I don't teach you how to find the average rate of change just given a certain value and a time difference. Okay, so everything gets changed here. Instead of writing C of B, I'm going to write C of X plus delta X. Instead of writing C of A, I'm going to write C of X. And that delta X can stay the same. That's fine. It's kind of a weird looking formula. But that's it. That's where we're going to stop with our formula. That's the slope of a secant line between a point X and another point, which is delta X away from it. It's also the rate of change. Also, I don't like this C, this cost thing. I call it C all the time. All right, I'm going to call it F. F. Make it a little bit more mathematical. F of X plus delta X minus F of X all over delta X. Now, I don't know about you, but I can. Maybe you can too. Do you see how this just kind of is literally like the slope formula? It's Y2 minus Y1 over X2 minus X1. You see that? Because X2 minus X1 is that delta X. That's your run. And this is your rise, y2 minus y1. Can y'all see that?
Mm-hmm.
Okay. So really, I know it's a whole bunch of hullabaloo and stuff like that, but really what it is, it's just a slope formula. Little advertisement here. In calculus, when you take AP calculus next year, it's really all about two things, slopes and areas. That's it. And we spend the first semester dealing with this stuff, dealing with slopes. All right, so you've already seen this, so you're not going to be scared when you do. We have a special name for it, other than the slope of the secant line or the average rate of change of a function. We also call it, because we like to have multiple names for different things, the difference quotient. So three separate names, or four, I think. Slope of the secant line, average rate of change, difference quotient. And you can tell how creative we are based on the name. Okay? Because, oh my gosh, why do you think they call it the difference quotient?
Maybe because there's subtracting and then dividing.
Yeah, that's pretty much it, right? Nice. There's a difference and there's a quotient. Yeah, I know. That's whatever. That's what we decided to do. Okay, we're going to do some practice problems here together. Sure. more just pass them back. Same thing for y'all. Alright, if you don't have a calculator, go ahead and walk up here and let's grab a calculator. Well, this is eternally loading. Just go ahead and get started. All right, first question. Read that off to us, Miranda.
Find the average rate of change of g of x equals 2x squared plus 8 when x equals 4 to x equals 7.
Okay. I don't know if you are a visual person. Well, Miranda, I know you are. But for the rest of you, 2x squared plus 8, anybody know what that graph looks like? Parabola, opening up or down? Up. Y-intercept?
8.
Okay, so there's 8. Looking something kind of exactly like that. We want to figure out what's the change from 4 to 7. So, what's the average rate of change? So, what's the slope of the secant line? How much does it go up over that period of time?
So we have to find the points for both of those?
You could, if you wanted to. In fact, that's exactly what we would find, the average rate of change. So that's going to be the change vertically minus the change horizontally. So what you could do is you could plug in g of 7, figure out what that is, minus g of 4, and then divide that by 7 minus 4. So if you plug that in the calculator, you should be able to get that. What's g of 7? Anybody have an answer on that one?
106.
106? Mm-hmm. All right. G of 4?
40.
Over 3.
Yeah.
Do we have agreement from the crowd?
Mm-hmm.
All right, there we go. And that's all there is to it. Find the average rate of change, find how much it changed vertically, divide by how much it changed horizontally. Number two, find the average rate of change of h of x, that's x cubed minus 3x squared plus 2x, from negative 2 to positive 2. If you want to, you can graph it. You don't have to. It's a cubic, so I know it's going to look something, I mean, kind of like that. I don't know how it's shifted. This is definitely shifted, you know, up and down and to the left or right or whatever. But I'm just looking at from negative 2 to positive 2, maybe something like that. I don't know. You can graph it on your calculator to see exactly what the region looks like. But it's almost sort of like, why even bother? I just maybe to double check your work, make sure you've got you're in the right territory. So x cubed minus 3x squared Okay, so actual graph has a little doo-wop there, but still, negative negative two is over here, positive two, right about there. Might be looking something like that. But that's going to give us a reality check. What kind of slope are we expecting?
Positive
slope. All right. So average rate of change, I'm just going to write m secant, is going to be h of 2 minus h of negative 2 all over 2 minus negative 2. This is where the table can also come into hand. Come in handy here. I get 0 for h of 2, negative 2, negative 24. Make sure everything's right here. 2 minus negative 2 is a 4. So positive 24 over 4 is 6. And then we look here just to verify. The graph really kind of helps out. Yep, it's positive. And there you go. All right, any questions on these first parts? Problems? All right, let's turn the page. Nancy, read to us number 4.
Graph of a function is shown below. Is the graph of a function defined an average rate of change from x equal to negative 5 to x equal to negative 2?
Okay. Alright. So I don't even have to, I just got the graph right here. Negative 5. Oh, they're so good. It actually is at that point there, a value 1. And negative 2. There we go. So average rate of change is going to be the slope of the secant line. So we literally have to find the slope. Never thought you'd be doing this in pre-calc, huh? Alright, here we go. Average rate of change is the change of y's over the change in x's. So it looks like 1, 2, 3. And 1, 2, 3. Came up with negative 1. What about you?
Mm-hmm.
That's it. Do y'all understand how that's the average rate of change? It's how much it's changed, how much got up and down, you know, over that time period. Now, normally when students see the word average, they tend to start thinking mean, okay? Like add all the numbers up and then divide by the number of numbers. Do not let that association confuse you. That's not what we're doing here. It's average rate of change in terms of like, how much has it changed on average? There is a top secret relationship between what we're dealing with and average that actually is the sum of everything divided by the number of numbers, but you don't get to figure that part out until calculus, okay? So right now, as far as you're concerned, this has nothing to do with the average. It's just called average, all right? Jasmine, what about this next problem, number 5?
Alright,
so negative 6 is right there, negative 2 is right there. If I draw that secant line, it's going to look just like that. What do you think, Jasmine?
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, 0. 0 is what? Yes, yeah, say the whole thing.
0 is the rate of change.
Not the rate of change. It's the average rate of change. Okay? By the way, teacher curious, the super top secret thing is, if you were to go from this point to this point, and this point to this point, this point to this point, this point to this point, like infinitely, you get a bunch of like negative slopes, a bunch of negative rates of change, and then if you were to do that, and this slope, 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 and do it like a million times, and then another million times, and infinitely, okay, and add all those up, notice these are all negative, and those are all positive, okay? And you end up canceling each other out.
That's what I figured it was.
A bunch of negatives, yeah. And that's why we say it's the average rate of change. And so it is related in calculus. We tell you the secrets of the universe, such as how to add up an infinite number of things and get a real number at the end. It's pretty cool, actually. We will begin to see that process just in a week or two when we start talking about limits. So that's kind of fun. All right, here we go. Crystal, number 6, read that to us, please.
The number of bacteria in a culture increases rapidly. The table below gives the number n of t of bacteria at few times when t in hours after the moment when n equals 1,000.
Okay, that's interesting. The very first couple of problems, they gave us the function, find the average rate of change. Then they gave us a graph, find the average rate of change. Now it's a table, find the average rate of change. It's one of the things we like to do in mathematics is give you multiple representations of a functional relationship and see if you can answer the question. In this case, the question, if we look at it, we've got time, we've got some values, how much bacteria, ooh, not all bacteria is bad, but still ooh. All right, they've measured it. This is a few times after the moment when n equals 1,000. Okay, so they know when it's 1,000 and then they start keeping track. Find the average rate of change for the number of bacteria from hour 0 to hour 3.4. Okay, so average rate of change is going to be, it's the change in y over the change in x. In this case, what value, what letter are we using to represent our y value, our dependent value? Nope, not time.
N.
N is our dependent quantity. So it's going to be the change in n over, what's our independent variable here?
T.
T for time, so delta n over delta t. If it helps you to call this x and this y, then that's fine too. So it's going to be the final value, 1340. Minus the initial value, 1,000, divided by change in time. If you want to, you could write 3.4 minus 0, but if you look at there, you know it's 3.4. All right, calculators, what is the answer here? 100. What are the units on that?
Bacteria
per hour. What are the units here in this numerator? It's 1340. What? Bacteria minus 1,000 bacteria. So that's bacteria in the numerator. 3.4 what? Hours minus 0 hours. That's how you get bacteria per hour. So this is 100 over 1 bacteria per hour. Or you could say 100 bacteria per hour. Find the average rate of change for the number of bacteria from hour from 8.5 to 13.6. So that's from this time right here to that time right there. So in that case, my final 3992 minus 2105 bacteria divided by 13.6 hours minus 8.5 hours. So make sure you don't make an algebra 1 mistake and forget to put all this stuff in the parentheses.
370.
370 is the correct answer, and what are the units?
Bacteria per hour.
Yeah. It could be pedantic and say 370 over 1 bacteria per hour, 370 bacteria per 1 hour, or we just say 370 bacteria per hour. All right, let's see if there's anything harder here. You know what, I think that's a good place to stop, and tomorrow we'll pick up and try those ones with all the algebra stuff, and then you'll be good to go. So it'll be probably about maybe 10-15 minute stops tomorrow, and then I'll give you the rest of the time to work on that. All right, Alex, just stop. Okay,